So let's begin. Campus is Radical Commons. So firstly, thank you everyone for being here and welcome to the discussion. I've been looking forward to this for quite a long time, I have to say, because it brings together a group of people that I've been wanting to see in dialogue for some time, for reasons I'll touch on. But in moving towards the sort of the outline of this event and what we're trying to do here as an introduction to the speakers, I'm just going to introduce that through also introducing this program, Radical Work. The program itself emerged through a happy intersection between our new Visiting Architects and Experts program and then a suggestion by one of our staff members, Jasper Ludwig, that we assemble a set of questions or a thematic that, you know, across all of our courses that in the architecture program that all of the courses might address in some way, particularly perhaps in the design studio programs, but also across subjects such as history and theory, and that this would create explicit connections for students across subjects and across years and between staff, along with and in contact with a rich array of staff and visiting experts from different, largely architects, but also from different fields. So this desire to create new connections was a response to the distancing effect of COVID. And the website as such was sort of named to suit, and you'll notice that the name of the website itself is UONARC Commons. And the program is, in a sense, designed to become a commons for us. So we set up this Semester 2 task force to deal with how to shape Semester 2 in the midst of COVID as a special circumstance that all of the Semester 2 coordinators need to think through after the unexpected disruptions of Semester 1 that we had to deal with. And so it was in the context of these two-hour weekly sessions that all the staff in architecture were invited to and most came, and that we developed the program that we referred to as the Themester. It's the thematic semester, but I keep calling it Themester. So it was very much, the point is that it was very much a collective effort and in putting this together. And I just want to take a moment to thank all of those who've put so much time and energy into making this happen at lightning speed in difficult circumstances and with a lot of really positive energy, and the staff have really been amazing. So Jasper's initial suggestion for the thematic was work. And for a while we talked collectively about the ways that we work as a title, to engage with, the degree to which COVID has changed the ways we work. And this is kind of outlined a bit in the opening essay in the website that talks about this issue of work and the ways that we work. But just prior to launching it, I saw this talk by Jack Self, who will be speaking on September 23 in the Radical Domesticities stream that was organised by Jasper. And Self, in this lecture that I saw, talked about the concept of radicality as something that was invented by monks in the medieval times, who saw a conflict between their idea of the world as having a static or essential nature and the obvious changes that they were seeing occur around them. And so this notion of radicality was a word they invented, which, like the word radish, comes from radical or from the root. So radicality becomes a snapback to the root of things. That's a correction, in a sense, from, you know, for the monks, from the drift from God's plan. So this really resonated with the conversations amongst staff that we'd been having, where at one point Beth George had raised the idea of the radical and the radish as something to think about in assembling future visions for the architecture programs, which, you know, like all architecture programs around the world, are in something of a crisis, and in that there's a need to deal with the massive changes in the university sector that have rendered ways of working, teaching and researching difficult to sustain in the same form. And so with all of those kinds of intersections, we shifted it to the title to radical work. And so and radical then being for us, as opposed to the monks in medieval times, about rethinking the ways which we work, not necessarily in order to become more productive or more efficient or to return to some mythical origin, but to clarify the values, relationships and objectives, or the root causes that might affirmatively shape work into the future. So this particular event, looking at the campus as a radical commons, has a really special significance in the program because it addresses the core imperative of it in spatial grounded and place-based ways. So a commons, as the other word, having spoken about radical, the commons is generally understood as a shared or non-privatised realm that exceeds ownership. And we put forward this proposition of the radical commons as something that takes us to that is a deeper ontological dive. So past the human to a more than human or ecological shared realm that we can, and culturally shared realm that we can reconsider and reshape our worldviews. And by that, I mean our worldviews that shape almost every action we undertake. So the radicality, the return to this sort of ontological root, if you like. But the proposition, I suppose, fundamentally is that the university campus might be seen as something like a radical network or meshwork requiring ecological thinking and sympathetic attention to the ethics of encounter. So I just also quickly want to acknowledge here the work of Olivia Hamilton, who I'm hoping to involve in an event later in the semester. And Olivia works at RMIT, where I used to work. And she did a PhD on commoning that I supervised. And commoning takes the idea of the commons further in that it becomes a verb or an action. And Olivia explored this through design process and developed a concept of creative mutuality as the underpinning for commoning. And Olivia taught me an enormous amount and really allowed me to appreciate the value of commoning as an ethos and an ethic. And that's today what I'm hoping we'll move towards, in a sense, not explicitly, but implicitly, towards sort of the generative conversation about the potential of the university campus to be founded on such an ethos and to become a radical commons as a site for commoning for students, academic and professional staff, for sessionals, for the public, and for many other living creatures and entities, such as rocks, for instance, that inhabit the world with us. So the speakers that we have today each bring some really extraordinary projects and work that deal with campuses in different ways and open them up from, I would say, conventional or traditional ways of understanding the campus that I think that we can all learn from. Before I go any further, however, I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land of the many campuses that we have at UON and in our many different places that we're in around Australia. I'm in Melbourne right now. So we are all inhabiting different places and different parts of the country. And also Ian is in the United States with traditional owners relevant to that place that he's in. So we're talking very much today about place, and Jufa Greenaway will be specifically talking about Indigenous cultural issues in relation to the campus. So this is especially important today that we acknowledge the many traditional owners of the places where we are inhabiting, both actually and virtually. So each of the speakers that we have brings a, you know, obviously these different projects. I think the plan we have for today is that each person is going to talk for 20 minutes. We'll have a brief period of time for some questions, maybe 5 minutes, and then we'll move to the next speaker, and then we'll have a larger discussion at the end. The order of the day, if you like, is that we're going to start with Jifa Greenaway, then we're moving to Ian Kerr, and then Ken McBride, and then we're going to finish up with Sue Ann Ware, who's going to specifically be addressing many initiatives at the UON campuses. I'm going to introduce each person as we go, I think, rather than all up at once. And I think each person is going to be sharing their screen to show their images. So I'm going to stop share. And I'm going to, sorry, just have to. So our first speaker today is Jifa Greenaway. I've been really wanting to get Jifa here to speak at UON for some time because of the work, the extraordinary work and leading work that he's been doing at the University of Melbourne with their campus. So Jifa shares both Aboriginal and German heritage and is founding director of Greenaway Architects, which was established in 1998. He's a University of Melbourne senior academic and a regular design commentator on ABC Radio Melbourne. So Jifa's championed Indigenous-led thinking for over 25 years, including as co-founder of Indigenous Architecture and Design Victoria with Ruben Berg, and as co-author of the acclaimed International Indigenous Design Charter that I think many here will be familiar with. And Jifa was recently inducted to the Design Institute of Australia's Hall of Fame as a co-curator of, and is a co-curator of the Australian exhibition at the Venice Biennale in 2021, which people were just talking about prior to starting, that's coming up, which is really exciting. And Jifa is a founding signatory of Architects Declare Australia. So Jifa, over to you.
Thank you. So I'll just share my screen, so hopefully that will come up. So has that come up now?
Yep. Yes.
Okay, terrific. Okay, so thanks for having me. I'm pleased to join this conversation and to really interrogate the proposition that has been put forward. And the title of my presentation is The River of No Sound, Healing Country on Campus. And this will reveal itself in terms of the significance of the title. So let me just advance. Bear with me. So I'd firstly like to say and use language. So Yama, or welcome. So my name is Jifa Greenaway, and it is always important and is custom and protocol to introduce oneself and to communicate who you are and where you're from. And so that is certainly what I do in all the presentations that I undertake. So I'd first just like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land in which I'm gathering, those of the Kulin Nation, particularly the Wurundjeri and the Boonwurrung, and acknowledge that we are located on the unceded sovereign lands wherever we are in the Australian context. And so that, I think, is a really important premise to start our conversation. So by way of a bit of a background to who I am, so my mob is Wailwong Kamilaroi country, which is northwest New South Wales. And interestingly, I actually grew up on Gadigal country, and then I moved to Darkinjung country, and now I live on cooler nation country. So you can see that multiplicity, that diversity that represents the vast continent that is now known as Australia. And what that really talks to is the, you know, rich tapestry that is Indigenous Australia. So by way of a bit of background, there is a really interesting link through time as it relates to my heritage. So my father was actually born 6 years after Federation. He was there at the National Day of Mourning in 1938. He signed up as a soldier in the Second World War. He was lobbying for at least a decade for the 67 referendum. He was mentored by significant figures like William Cooper. In turn, he mentored people like Charlie Perkins. So there is a really interesting link through history and time. But on the other side of my family, my mother and grandparents came here after the Second World War from war-torn Germany. And interestingly enough, they almost didn't quite make it the ship that came over to Australia was the only ship to have sunk en route to Australia during that vast migration from Europe after the Second World War. So this bicultural experience, this blend of different cultures is what I sort of bring to the table. And significantly, you know, this informs my way of practice and way of working. And so I often describe myself through the four A's: Aboriginal. The second one is as an architect. And so that is the means of cultural expression which I undertake. So our practice is a holistic practice. It moves beyond the silos of different segments or disciplines. So, you know, whether it's architecture, landscape architecture, interior design, urban design, that isn't really our concern. The concern is finding a creative solution to solve the challenges that are put before us as practitioners. As was mentioned, I'm also an academic at the University of Melbourne, and my role is actually to indigenise the design degree at the University of Melbourne, which cuts across 12 design disciplines. And so my task is to embed Indigenous sensibilities, knowledge systems, and ways of knowing within the teaching of design and design practice. And thirdly, I'm an advocate. And interestingly enough, I actually started off in my journey studying political science. And so the notion of advocacy is embedded in my sort of way of operating, knowing that being an Aboriginal architect is inherently political. And so there is a role and a responsibility and a contribution to advocate for meaningful change. And to that end, along with Ruben Berg and myself, we founded the only peak body representing Indigenous design practitioners within Australia. And so we're starting from a fairly low base in that there are, as best as we can determine, maybe 7 or 8 registered Indigenous architects in private practice across the entire country. There are probably 25 people who have graduated from schools of architecture nationally. But promisingly, there is somewhere in the order of 70 students in the system across the country studying within architecture and the built environment disciplines. So I'd just like to start with this particular quote. If nothing of your culture, history, language, or art is visible in the streets, parks, and buildings where you live, how can you ever feel welcome there? So I think that is particularly salient and significant in the context of this conversation. And so we're seeing a vast change and a reckoning around the conversations, particularly with Black Design Matters. And it raises a number of really compelling and important conversations. And it's infusing with some difficult truths as it relates to the colonial project, which has very much influenced particularly Western culture and how it intersects with country. And so this challenging of the standard tropes of how we understand history is certainly something which we need to grapple with. And revealing those layers of history and memory of place is, in many respects, what we do within practice. in the work that we undertake. So certainly there is a role and a contribution by everybody to start to think about what is one's contribution in changing the status quo, to moving to a transformative way of thinking about design practice. And so this notion of Black Lives Matter has become a catalyst to interrogate how it impacts on the spatialization and the impacts of the colonial project and how we can start to redress the balance. And so we're seeing, and it's started to occur over a number of years now, is an understanding that we can interface with the built environment and the cities and towns and places in which we live to understand a more nuanced relationship to history. So whether it's starting to create significant markers within the public realm which talk to some of these difficult truths, we can see that there is certainly a significant contribution that architects and creatives can have in terms of starting to think about the mechanisms of how we empower Indigenous agency into projects. And so whether it's through, you know, challenging some of the standard tropes around terra nullius, or starting to embed and infuse stories which reflect country and talk to the multiplicity of different language groups and the rich mosaic and tapestry that is Indigenous Australia, is certainly coming to the fore. And so we're starting to see a real contribution by practitioners to be innovative in how we tackle these big questions. And so what we're also seeing is the various peak design bodies are coming on board. They're understanding the importance of starting to develop strategies and language and resources to empower practitioners to understand their contribution in this space, but also to develop an approach where we can start to impact and create meaningful change. But also what we're seeing is the academy, universities are starting to tackle this question as well. And so what we're certainly wanting to see is a much more inclusive approach to design practice and design teaching. And so across the globe, we're starting to have a repositioning of the contribution of the design profession to create the requisite time and space to have these conversations in meaningful ways. And so in the Victorian context where I'm located, this has taken on an even greater significance in as much as we have actually legislated for treaty conversations. And it poses the bigger question of how does the built environment disciplines need to change and adapt with this new reality on the horizon? So when we start to position sovereign relations, what that presupposes is the way in which we relate to a connection to country and placemaking takes on a different hue as it relates to how we go about this. And so what we're certainly seeing is a reassertion of the importance of Indigenous voices as being cultural interlocutors to have these conversations. And so I curated an exhibition a couple of years ago, which was the first national survey of contemporary Indigenous design, surprisingly. And I titled it Black Design Matters. And the reason it was framed in those terms is if we don't have visibility of culture, if we can't develop a conversation which talks to the deep history, the 67,000 years of continuous occupation of this land, we can't really advance the conversation in a meaningful way. And in reality, we can certainly posit that all projects are in reality built on Aboriginal lands in the Australian context. And I also acknowledge Torres Strait Islander lands off the mainland as well. So again, what this does is it centres an understanding of how we can find a mechanism and a connection to this deeper history. And so I'm interested in unmapping country, in healing country, in revealing the layers of history and memory of place. while moving beyond what could be called the post-Copernican stress disorder that we as architects are somehow the center of the world. I'm interested in speaking to the truth of architecture in all that I do, while creating culturally informed environments embedded through Indigenous knowledge systems. And so the way in which I'd seek to really explore this and unpack this conversation and the meaning that underpins it is through demonstrating a case study of a project that we've been working on for the last 2.5 years, known as the New Student Precinct Project at the University of Melbourne. And so interestingly, this project has been incorporated and embedded within the Reconciliation Action Plan of the university as a signature project. So what that essentially does is it raises the bar of how we start to think about reconciliation at scale embedded within a university environment. And so the starting premise was to create an immersive and deep engagement strategy. So to give you a bit of a context, this is a 2.5 hectare site. It incorporates the transformation of 5 existing buildings, adding 2 new buildings, and stitched together by an overarching landscape and urban design strategy. And what it really centers on is an understanding of how we start to talk to an understanding of country. And so in doing this, what we've actually done is we've created in parallel to the design exercise, a strategy which facilitates Indigenous agency. And so the way we do this is we engage with traditional owner groups. And in the context of this project, we've engaged with 4 traditional owner groups. We've spoken to the Indigenous leadership of the university at Chancellery level. We've spoken to Indigenous staff, Indigenous students. We managed to capture the voices of 1/4 of every Indigenous student on campus, unprecedented. And we've looped that back into developing design thinking and strategy as part of a design consortia, which is made up of 5 architectural practices and 2 landscape architectural practices. And so what we've also done is we've pressure tested our own ways of working. So we've benchmarked the process against the International Indigenous Design Charter. And so what this does is it enables us to pressure test our ways of working to ensure that we embed culturally responsive design practice. And so this raises a range of complex but interconnected questions which need to be understood and addressed as part of the methodology of how we undertake this particular project. And so these different domains start to raise questions which aren't necessarily typically understood in the context of design. So things like understanding the role and the contribution of Indigenous cultural intellectual property rights, of understanding how we facilitate deep listening and meaningful conversations, which move beyond the transactional model to a relational model. How do we embed self-determination? How do we are we informed by Indigenous knowledge systems? And how do we ensure that a project of this significance is in fact Indigenous led? So these are just a series of key provocations to ensure that we develop new ways of working. And so what we've also done is we've underpinned it through an engagement framework which talks to a number of important domains of connecting to country, the importance of a place-centered approach which is located in a particular area which talks to those specificities of place, of the notion of art and artifact. So in other words, understanding that in the context of architecture, we often privilege the end product over the process and the journey of getting there. And art is really a catch-all to talk to cultural expression. And I would argue that often we default to the only understanding of art or creative practice as pictorial art in the Indigenous lens. But I would note that architecture, interior design, urban design, landscape, architecture are other forms of cultural expression. Equally, the importance of connecting to people, connecting to language, connecting to different relationships and relationality as critical, but also understanding that whenever we engage with country, we will reveal layers of history and memory and often confront some difficult truths. And so this was the engagement framework that we created in parallel to being involved and embedded as part of the design team. And so the starting premise is really to reveal an understanding of place. So this particular campus was a lightly wooded area. Traversing through this campus was a series of watercourses. Interestingly, there are a series of river redgums within the campus to this very day, which are estimated to be somewhere in the order of 400 years old. So they predate first contact. And so importantly, what we reveal through this understanding of a connection to place is that the first moves in the establishment of this university, which is the second oldest university in the country, was the remnants of country informed some of the decision-making of the campus. So the first building on campus was the old quadrangle building. And so it was supposed to align with an idea of a public park on axis, but it actually had to shift and evolve to respond to the natural scenario of a terrain which was quite wet and difficult to build on. So the path of least resistance is to relocate and to build to respond to the natural attributes and topography and understanding of place. And interestingly, and you can see the image here on the left-hand side, is where the site is located. It's bounded on the corner of the campus, but also it stitches into an overarching understanding of the greater campus and the relocation and recentering of the campus to start to pivot towards its relationship to the city, stitching back into the broader understanding of its macro understanding of its place, but also noting that there is a new metro tunnel system and a new rail infrastructure being incorporated on Grattan Street, as you can see there, which certainly acknowledges the migration of the campus as moving closer to the city. And what we also always seek to understand is a broader understanding of how it sits within its relationship to Melbourne, and that there are a series of moments that talk to the deep history. So I often say that you can concrete over country, but country still exists. The stories, the narratives still remain. The significance and the relationships to key moments through time are revealed as it relates to that broader urban gesture. And so what we also did is we looked through the historical records, through some of the colonial records, and also to the pictorial representations of country as a way of mapping and understanding the relationality to some of those deeper stories. And so what we revealed adjacent to this site is a street named Bouverie Street, which was actually known as Bouverie Creek. We also understood that further north of where this site was located was an ornamental lake within the university, which was concreted over and euphemistically known as the concrete lawn. And as you saw in those previous images of the mapping of country, we also demonstrated that there was a series of river redgums, which automatically tells you there must have been watercourses traversing through the campus. And as we often know, some of the infrastructure of the creek lines and the watercourses that traverse through our cities, through the act of colonization and the act of architecture as a colonizing device, we often pipe the old creek lines. And so what we revealed through conversations with the traditional knowledge keepers, the traditional owners and elders, is that to this very day, the stormwater systems which essentially piped the old creek line, through oral history and validation through the conversations and the deep listening with traditional owner groups, was that there is an eel migration that traverses through the stormwater system under the university campus to this very day. And occasionally what we see during winter when there are big downfalls of rain through the various ponds and through grates and stormwater pits is that the eels pop their heads up. And so through the piping of the old watercourses from this creek line which traverses through the university, which connects to Bouverie Creek, which then connects to Elizabeth Street, which was also a creek, that then dumps into the Yarra River and then by extension into the bay. And so what this talks to is Indigenous resilience. And so that parallel story is really engaging. And interestingly enough, the new Indigenous unit for the university just so happens to be located in front of this old creek line. And so that became the stimulus to create a cultural narrative to daylight the old watercourse as part of an urban design strategy informed by Indigenous ways and knowing, and creating an opportunity where we've obtained the cultural imprimatur to proceed and to tell particular stories. And so what we also did through this intensive engagement strategy, which occurred over the course of 18 months in parallel to the design work, is we themed and mapped the feedback and the powerful insights that we heard by engaging with Indigenous voices. And so what we then did is we looked at it across a number of different domains. We looked at it through developing a cultural narrative. So understanding that we are essentially walking within the footsteps of our ancestors, that there should be markers and signposts of stories, of the understanding of creating a learning landscape or a pedagogical landscape to facilitate knowledge exchange, at looking at opportunities of how we interpret and embed and infuse a normative understanding of connection to country, and then theming it through design action. So looking at how we start to shift from the standard tropes around Indigenous culture of Indigenous equals primitivism to understand and embrace a living culture, which is constantly changing and adapting, and that can be equally contemporary, unashamedly so, and facilitating moments where we start to create a personality through color, texture, materiality, but moving beyond a representational approach to country. And as Professor Deb Cheatham explains quite evocatively, you can't sight read culture. And what that essentially means is the museumization of culture, the muralization of culture is a surface treatment and applique which only goes skin deep. We want to embed within the DNA of the design thinking an understanding and a connection to Indigenous culture. But equally, what the third theme that we focused on was activation. So understanding that the experience of people coming on campus, whether they are students, staff or visitors, starts to create a normative experience and connection to 3,000 generations of history. And so to that end, we facilitate moments of ceremony, of traditional practice of welcome, of looking at facilitating a dialogue around the bioregion of this project through landscape, understanding opportunities around digital installation, of stitching together within the understanding of the various opportunities of the events that occur through the calendar of the year, looking at things like projections, looking at art installations, looking at procurement policies to empower Indigenous enterprise, looking at the incorporation of a bicultural experience through language, and signifying the importance of Indigenous figures through history as part of the understanding of how we amplify a connection to culture. And so then what we did is we geo-referenced some of these key pillars as it relates to these particular thematics, and then understood how that will start to inform and translate into a design proposition. And then what we did is we mapped that against the engagement framework as a way of looping back and having a conversation with traditional owners to demonstrate the importance and significance of their contribution in developing a methodology which has actually become the impetus for the design thinking across all of the project. So not only does it start to develop a cultural narrative, but it starts to develop a language as it relates to the architecture, the interior design, the urban design, the wayfinding, the landscape architecture, and the like. And so what we also sought to do was look at some of the moments where we start to create an experience which starts to embed itself within the normative way in which we experience and connect to notions of learning and knowledge exchange. And then you can see here how we've incorporated a water story, the daylighting of the old creek lines as part of the way in which we talk to country. And it folds in under the buildings and through the public domain and start to reposition an understanding of the old desire lines, which were in essence the old sort of walking tracks, the song lines of country as well. And so you can see how this starts to create design inspiration and starts to become something which is powerful and evocative in the stories that we tell through an understanding of the significance of the voices of Indigenous people coming through into the very fiber of this particular project and embedded in an integrated mechanism of design practice. And so you can see here the representation through the plan of how this actually manifests itself, creating a welcome ground, creating moments where we connect to water as part of the river narrative embedded within place. And then also understanding the importance of the interconnectedness between landscape, between grooming of the landscape, knowing that the Indigenous cultures have always been the architects, the engineers, the landscape architects, and they have manipulated the landscape to suit human occupation. So it starts to challenge some of those standard ways in which we think about Indigenous culture as lacking sophistication. But there is great wisdom in 67,000 years of continuous occupation of the oldest continuing living culture on the planet. And so you can see how this starts to manifest itself through a series of built form interventions, which starts to envelop itself by a story which is anchored in deep history, in deep knowledge and deep understanding. And so it reminds me of a particular conversation that we had with one of the traditional owners through this engagement strategies. And what they spoke to is that Tunurong, which is one of the five Kulin nations north of Melbourne, when they used to come down to Melbourne for a Tandarum, which was the gathering of the five Kulin nations, on a classic gathering place to this very day being where the MCG is, the Melbourne Cricket Ground, the cathedral for gathering through sport. And so they would camp here at the university campus. And so why would you camp at the university campus if there was no shelter, if there was no fresh water, if it wasn't a place of refuge, if you didn't have an outlook? And so what it does, it reminds our understanding of the oral history and the knowledge that resides through oral history and the connection to those stories around place. And so we can see a series of renderings which also pivots to an understanding that what we're seeking to do is give visibility to culture. And so the Indigenous unit now has a public-facing relationship to the city. It has an address to the urban domain by connecting to the significance of the primary entry point into the campus. And so I'd just like to leave you with a couple of take-home messages. The importance of deep listening, of understanding that as practitioners that we are often the least knowledgeable people in the room. We need to park our ego at the door because importantly we are reliant upon Indigenous knowledge keepers to facilitate a conversation and knowledge exchange. Knowing too that invariably we will reveal layers of history and memory as we intersect with connection to country, and often that will engage with some difficult truths. And so we do not shy away from this. We embrace this as part of the broader experience of how we engage with place. This notion of truth-telling will certainly reveal itself as part of the mechanism of how we engage. And so we have to confront some of these understandings that architecture has been complicit in the colonial story. And importantly, the moments of how we engage with these layers is they can become a mechanism, an enabler for transformative design practice. So I'll leave it there and I'll say Mariu Yanaya. Go well. Thank you.
Thank you, Jifa. That was fantastic. And I just thank you so much, not just for speaking, but also for doing this work. It's really incredibly, incredibly important and inspiring. I'd really like to squeeze in one question, if we can, before we move to the next person, if there is anyone who would like to ask something related to this talk. We're getting lots of thank. We're getting thank yous and awesome on the side. But does anyone want to?
Ken's put his hand up. Just need to unmute, Ken.
Madam Chairman, Pia, would you mind if I take a question, given, or should we leave it for the students?
Oh, please do. Please go for a question.
Jifa, thank you very much for a remarkable presentation. It's perhaps more of an observation, but that it is a question. Given Indigenous history and the process of learning is based on oral history, how can we best deal with this desperate shortage of time we have to capture that oral history, that knowledge through oral history, all across this nation?
Yeah, I get similar sort of questions quite often in terms of, particularly in an architectural program, for instance, often we say, we don't have time to embed an integrated and deep engagement with traditional owners or knowledge keepers. And I actually switch that sort of question and say, what is your risk appetite for it to go pear-shaped by not actually taking Indigenous people on the journey with you? And so I often say that often you need to slow down to speed up. You actually have to facilitate and find the opportunity and carve out the requisite time and space to have meaningful conversations with the right people. And if nothing else, what it actually does is it provides ample capacity for design inspiration. You know, for me, you know, the stories and the engagements and the privilege of actually speaking to, you know, the deep wisdom of Indigenous voices is powerful and transformative. And so it is an imperative to start to understand, you know, whose country are we working on and how do we find a moment and an opportunity to engage with it as part of the normative way in which we practice. And so the ways of working of where we start to embrace this, I think is a responsibility that we all have.
Thank you. I'm actually, may I refine the question a little? I'm not talking about we as practitioners on a project that might be 2 or 3 years. I'm talking about we as a nation seem to have a very short amount of time given the aging of the elders and the lack of teaching around language. We have a very short amount of time to capture this 67,000 years of knowledge.
Yeah, well, that is an intractable challenge in many respects because in reality, the traditional knowledge keepers, traditional owner groups, recognised Aboriginal parties, land councils and the like, they are inundated with inquiries. They seek to be very generous in facilitating knowledge exchange, but they don't actually have the requisite resources to facilitate often their statutory obligations to contribute into propositions. And so it's actually having the requisite resources is certainly an important part of it, but also, you know, it's beholden on all of us to reach out, to have conversations, even incidentally. And there is certainly a lot of work that's happening within community to capture some of these oral histories, to record them, and to engage with them. And there is obviously amazing Indigenous scholars out there doing some fantastic work. There are obviously a plethora of fantastic publications which are seeking to really interface with those stories. But certainly, you know, it's a challenge. You know, undoubtedly, it is a big challenge that we're all confronted with.
I'll just say that a similar question came up in the forum we had at the beginning of semester around this, and the point was made that if we can have JobKeeper, I think we can probably afford to produce a whole lot of roles for Indigenous custodians of knowledge to actually make it their paid employment.
That's right, knowledge keeper.
Yeah, and that, exactly, and that should be a cultural role in Australia. We do have a couple more questions that come through. We might need to leave. I know Troy's got one, a really good one. Maybe we'll leave that to the end. Amber, do you want to quickly ask the question, because we do need to move to the next?
Yeah, hi, Jeff. Nice to meet you. I've got the book with your chapter in it, so it's nice. Yeah. You online.
There's another edition coming out soon.
Yeah, it's really exciting. It's actually like such a fantastic resource that, yeah, I think everyone should read. I guess my question was, in terms of being an architectural student and doing a project, you know, focused around or trying to incorporate Indigenous culture, and you're doing it in the setting of an architectural school, hence, you know, you don't want to, you can't pay anyone for their time, and that community-led and community engagement is sort of difficult to do, A, in the constraints, and B, in the fact that it's a speculative design. Do you have any tips for someone, yeah, trying to do this through the framework of architecture school?
Yeah, well, you know, I deal with this all the time. I run design studios all the time, which interface with Indigenous you know, thematics. And naturally, within a 12 or 13 week design studio period, you know, meaningful engagement is not realistic. But importantly, it's understanding what your contribution as an emerging practitioner is, and how do you actually build your own cultural intelligence. That is a critical part of the journey. So in many respects, we're all going on a learning journey of interfacing with Indigenous culture. And so in many respects, it's, building upon a quotation from a Turtle Island knowledge keeper from North America, from Canada, said to me recently, he said, you've got to fish from the river rather than from the bank. And what he was saying is you actually have to get your feet wet and engage with it, rather than from the periphery or the fringes. And so in other words, you actually have to have skin in the game. So you actually have to become invested personally and understand your own philosophical, ethical position as it relates to Indigenous culture. And that starts from building that cultural intelligence. Because ultimately, it's not the necessarily the role of Indigenous people to inform everybody. Everyone actually has to contribute into their own learning journey. And so I would say that is the starting point. There are fantastic resources out there. And so that is I think, that the useful starting point. And you know, naturally, you know, all universities have Indigenous units. Incidental conversations with Indigenous people can always inform one's own position.
Right. Thank you, Amber. Asking that's a good question. Thank you, Jifa. I know there's more questions which we'll return to at the end. But now we should move on to the next speaker, which is Ian Kerr. So Ian is someone currently, you know, who is located in the United States. It's evening for him right now, a different part of the day. I met Ian really some time ago via Arakar and Gin's a shared interest in their work. So quite these sort of, to use that word again, quite radical architects, artists in America. But Ian's work really works at the intersection of creativity, ecology, and emergent systems. And he's the director of the Mix Lab at Montclair State University and co-founder of the boundary blurring design consultancy called Spurs. So they've been developing some groundbreaking ways to probe, catalyze, disrupt, and reimagine systems, both large and small. And have done a lot of work collaborating with communities, organizations, and individuals from the high Arctic to inner cities, inner city neighborhoods in Bolivia. Their projects reveal an astonishing range of creative solutions to affecting real change, from restaurants, wetlands, wayfinding apps, urban renewal programs, microbiology labs, cookbooks, buildings, and everyday tools. And they've worked in a very diverse range of institutions. And Ian has done a project that really piqued my interest in relation to this called a multi-species commons. It was a campus as multi-species commons. We also had Ian do an event right in the first week of the Radical Work Program. It was a thinking room with the fourth and fifth years at that stage, which was really a remarkable 3-hour journey that he took us on. So I'm really looking forward to hearing from Ian today. Do you want to share screen or?
Thanks, Pia. Thank you, Jeff, for that. I think I'd like to take a moment before we really get into things to just move our bodies for a second and connect with our environments a bit. So I'm in the past, I'm in Thursday, you're in Friday. Here it's night and it's raining. I have no idea what it is there. And I would love it if you took a moment to just get up and as architects, open your windows and just acknowledge the, breathe in something that's not inside and stand up and move for a second. And let's hear things. I hope you all have windows that open. And, or doors that open. I think as we do that, let's sense where we are for a second. You know, as we sit down again, acknowledge our chairs. They're beings, like Pia was saying at the very beginning, like rocks that are part of our world. The room we're in, if we take a moment and just see that it's there. We're not just looking at human heads. And look at our bodies for a second. You know, your hands have millions of other species on them. You're not alone looking at each other. So just to stretch and take that moment, I hope the environment in your room has changed with the window being open, if it was closed before. So I just want to say a couple things about myself. So I'm originally from Northern Canada. I was born on the reservation of the Blackfoot Cree My father was working for them. And I grew up in the unceded territory of the Stamish people in Vancouver. And now I live in New Jersey, which is also the unceded territory of the Lenné Lenape people. And so I want to talk a bit and follow up some of the things Jeffa was saying on this idea of the commons. And I love, Pia, your website's title, that it's On Our Commons. So it's like a non-arche. It's an ungrounded commons we're talking about. You know, and the idea of radicality, as you were saying at the beginning, as roots, and that roots turn out not to be foundational. You know, that roots of plants and trees lead to fungal webs, and those fungal webs, you know, lead into the world horizontally, and they lead back to other trees. You know, and that every gram of soil has something like 500 million fungi in it. You know, so when we talk about, you know, grounding ourselves, we're grounding ourselves in something that, as Jeffa was describing, that grounds ourselves in 67,000 years of history, in billions of years of history, and something much more complicated than an easy understanding of the commons. So, you know, we've spent 20 years working on projects around the commons. And I think it's really important to start when we think about the commons, that we actually think about the opposite, the uncommons. I think it's too easy to talk about the commons as if we're talking about sameness. Like if something we have in common means we have the same thing in common. But what we really have in common is difference. And I think this is an ethical starting point to think about how we are together. And there's two important registers of this. And I, you know, Jeffa was talking about this important cosmological register of difference that, you know, traditional landholders and wisdom keepers and peoples of a place, they have a mode of being alive that's distinct from ours. That's just, you know, that there's, that in any one place one is, there's no one way of understanding its reality. There's profound ontological differences. So when we talk about being in common, we're talking about being in common with these kind of cosmological or ontological differences. And I think it's an important moment to critically register how we're approaching something is not universal. Which is to say, when we use words like nature or environment or culture, these are historically loaded terms that are all very recent, that are not shared by most non-European grounded cultures. So you can't translate the word nature into almost any other language. The idea that there's something separate from humans out there makes no sense in most languages, most cosmologies. So as we begin to think about what we have in common, I think we have to think that what we have in common is that there are many worlds in any one place. There's many ways of being alive, and they're not something like subjective or cultural, that they go deeper. And I think, as Jeffa was saying, when you live in a place for 67,000 years, it's not just ideas. It's a deep feedback between practices, mindsets, other species, environments, and it's building an entangled totality. And that is not reducible to expression. It's not reducible to ideas, but it's the very landscape that one lives in is ontologically loaded. And you know, we see this, in the creek Jeffa was talking about. We're working on a similar creek going through our town. It's not just there naturally, like without complex entanglement of peoples and other species. In our case, it's, humans, beavers, types of trees, have all conspired in a type of encounter to make that. And I don't think we could call that just culture. And I think that's a really important starting point. So when we encounter place, we don't encounter ideas, we encounter entangled cosmology that's connects many species together in shaping something. And I think this brings the second idea of difference that's really important to think about the commons, is that all of these species that you meet, so right now, we don't do a really good job of cleaning our house. So underneath my chair, there's a beautiful spider. It doesn't think of my chair as a chair. It thinks of it as the perfect habitat where the sun is coming through a window where my camera is, which faces south, and it warms up the carpet, and the carpet radiates up. Flies come in the window I just opened, and it thinks of it as something very different. And I think so when we talk about the commons, we're also talking about how each agent in that thing has a different perspective on it. So there's no way to talk about sameness when we talk about the commons. So there's these two, I think these two parts I just want to say at the beginning. There's the ontological, cosmological part. And then there's a kind of species environment thing part. And I like how Pia provoked us at the beginning by thinking of a rock as an agent. And I would certainly extend that. There's a way to think of every object in our environment. And I think it's especially important as architects and designers in whatever way we're thinking that, The chair has as much agency and a type of aliveness, or the table or a room. And to think of its difference, it's not reducible to us. And I think this is really important. Last point in this part of the commons is nothing is reducible to us. We have to start with a kind of irreducible difference and acknowledge that things have their own form of agency that exceeds us as an ethical starting point. There's nothing generic out there. And I think this is really important in terms of the politics of the commons. There's no such thing as water. There's no such thing as air. And as Jeffa pointed out, water is in a river. That river is connected to a people and a history. In our case with the Lenni Lenape, that river is an actual person. It's not generic. It's not H2O. It has a being, And I think that's really important. So that's the first things I want to say about common, that we have to start with the uncommon, with difference. The second thing is that when we meet the world, when we meet this spider or this river, or the air coming in your window or the rain that's outside mine, we don't encounter it as knowledge. And I think this is a really important thing. Like, it's not H2O, it's not rain. It's a sensed and immediately felt modality. And I think that's really important, that it can't be replaced with concepts. So what we really have in common with reality is a type of vicarious encounter, you know, that's shaped by cosmologies and habits and practices and many of the things that Jeffa was already talking about. But that encounter isn't intellectual, or it's not reducible primarily to an intellectual encounter. It's an experiential sensorial encounter. And I think what's important about that ethically is that when I see that spider, which is right here under my chair, I can't reduce it to a category like, oh, spiderness, and some knowledge I have of spiders. I'm encountering an actual unknowable being that I have to figure out how to deal with, that now I have a reality in common with. And this encounter is an encounter of difference, that I have to figure out what we have in common that's irreducible to categorization. And I think this is, you know, as designers, this is really important, where we want to put everything in something and we want to talk about, qualitative things. Quantitative things, I should say, you know, a biomass amount of rainfall, a something. But our primary mode of being alive and being in the world is not reducible to that. It's qualitative. And so that's the second part of thinking about the commons, that we need to move from a knowledge based modality to a kind of vicarious encounter. It's something more speculative. The next thing I want to say, this is the really last thing before showing a couple projects and examples, is that we have to critically interrogate the historical concept of the commons. You know, so the commons comes out of a long European history, and I think it's been reduced in some ways to something like a noun. And this is where I think the attention to language, again, as Jeffa was saying, is important. That historically, the commons wasn't a thing, you know, where you know, we have these great examples here of like the Boston Commons, like it's a space that everyone could occupy equally. And I think it's an easy thing as architects to think about, oh, we're talking about things, spaces, environments that we collectively are unownable or share. But the historical commons, primarily coming out of British political agencies of the Middle Ages, was a set of practices. It's better thought of as commoning. It has nothing to do with a set of objects. So, you know, a couple examples of this are really useful. So for example, farm fields in the Middle Ages in England were entirely shared. So it was, everybody worked the same fields, whether they were the lord or the farmer, and you got a share of it, but it was entirely held in common. And I think what's important about this is that it was a practice, a kind of political practice of refusing any form of ownership or identity with a thing, and putting politics into relationships. And I think this is really interesting for architecture, to think of what is an entirely relational mode of building. And how does architecture build relations rather than things, like static things? So the English political commons was a mode of holding together emergent relationships. And I think you can connect this to what Jeffa was talking about, of practices of managing a land, of an environment. Like, how do you hold together a relationship in our case here in New Jersey, between a beaver, a bacteria, a creek, a people, a number of practices. And that's where you begin a practice. You begin a kind of co-making. You don't begin by saying, well, this is this and this is that. But the relation is actually the defining feature and what that might look like. And I think this this grounds the idea of commons in a practice of commoning that's really about world making. And I think this is what's really important. You're not making things, but you're making modes of being alive and being entangled and being interdependent. And that is what grounds a kind of political commons. So I want to show you a project that gets at that a little bit, really quickly. So I'm gonna share my screen. So this is quickly our website. I can put these links in later, but we just did a really great project of an annotated bibliography called Ecology is Racist, It's Time to Eat. And I think it's really useful in, where Jeffa began with Black Lives Matter. The very way we're talking about nature and environment is highly problematic. And if we're trying to leave a kind of settler and colonial mindset, we can no longer talk about things like nature. We have to figure out how to step out of that. So the project I want to show began out of us writing a cookbook about how to be entangled and interdependent with our environment, which was called Eat Your Sidewalk. And I won't get into that, but this is a good slide, Forage into a New Worldview. Like, how could you, through action, come up with a new mode of being alive that entangles with history and place? So I wanna go into a project we did in Southern California, just outside of LA, called the Pitzer College Multi-Species Commons, because I think it gets exactly at what, how I understand it, what Pia's talking about with a campus as a radical commons. So we were invited by Pitzer College, which is a consortium of colleges, to rethink their environment as a type of art project. And so we worked with students and members of the community over a 2-year period to think of it as a type of multi-species commons. You know, based on the type of principles and ideas I was just talking about, you know, and in doing that, well, we started by, you know, paying attention to history and place. And, you know, California is an astonishingly interesting place to work in terms of indigenous environmental practices, where pretty much every species that is there still has a kind of human, non-human entanglement. There's a similar relation to Australia with fire, the importance of human fires as propagators of particular environments and indigenous historical practices. And this was an interesting spot where it's at the edge of the mountains that are just to the north of LA. So there's all sorts of creatures coming down from the mountains into the urban space. And it allowed us to think about urban space as a type of nature, you know, not as like a failed state of nature, but as an actual. And so we began with a concept that foraging, which is to say like picking and eating plants, would lead us to entangle with actual creatures. And I think this is a really important part. You know, and I think this sets these kind of projects apart from other ones with architecture. Like, what's the human relationship with the environment in most architectural practices? It's really you walk across it, you look at it, you might admire it, you might respect it, you're on a path, but you're not interdependent with a place. What happens to that place isn't happening to you. And so we really wanted to think of this concept of commons in that framework. Like, what's happening to the environment happens to us. We share a common history and trajectory. So, you know, when you eat a plant that's growing right under your feet, whatever you did to that landscape is now coming back through that plant to you. And the dependency changes. You know, it's not just something you look at. And so we wanted these students and the faculty to not understand environment as something conceptual, but as something direct, and that they depended on it and the environment depended on them. And there was a kind of co-emerging interdependency. And so the foraging part was fundamental to this. We wanted to get everybody on campus to eat the landscape, just like every fungi, bacteria, bee, worm, bird, fox, hawk, etc. was doing. And that there was no distinction, that humans weren't eating from some freshly clear-cut rainforest that's now organic in Brazil. So we developed with students a set of practices. We changed how the campus bought food, what was served in the cafeteria. We developed kitchens around campus and cooking clubs and student groups so that they would start to eat the campus, cook it. They would actually hunt for things. We worked with local hunters about getting students to eat rabbits and serve them on the menu of the campus. So we developed this foraging guide that looks at the entangled cosmologies of things, of the plants. We had students work on an actual cookbook for the campus. So making their own wines, martinis, you know, and non-alcoholic things as well. you know, then we co-authored with the students a kind of manifesto about it, which I encourage you to look at. I'm not going to go into it, but it touched on these entangled ways of being. And then we developed an instruction for use.
You know, to raise a bit of time, a time flag.
Sorry, Kia?
Oh, I just said I just have to raise a bit of a time flag. We're running out of time.
Cool. I can stop right here. So people can take a look at how, you know, these practices were put into place. I think what's really important here is that rather than starting by thinking the end goal was to like make objects like buildings and what have you, the goal was to develop practices, and that those practices would lead to emergent ontologies that connected to histories and differences, and that could give rise to a kind of campus-wide dialogue on what should happen next. So in a highly collaborative and generative manner. So I can stop there, Pia.
Thank you very much, Ian. And the link to that Spitzer College thing I've added to the website for everyone, so that under associated reading with the campus's Radical Commons section, so people can explore that in greater detail. I think we're going to have to skip questions at the end of this part because I'm just getting really worried about time. So we do have some time for a little bit of discussion at the end. So I might just, if that's okay, if we can just move. That was a beautiful follow-on from what Jifa was showing us. And now if we could move to Ken McBride. So I need to introduce you, Ken. So Ken is an architect and an award-winning architect, and he's recently been appointed as a conjoint professor of practice at our University of Newcastle. He founded architectural physics as a practice in 2018 to respond to design challenges that demand sustainable, innovative placemaking ideas. He has an affinity with construction methodologies, prefab and materials technology, which underpins his approach. Ken has some very interesting projects that he can show us today. And so I might just hand over to you there, Ken. You'll need to unmute. I've unmuted you.
Thank you. How's everyone feeling? Whack a little note in the chat. That's pretty inspiring so far. I will move nice and quickly. Just pop something in the chat. Let me know how you're going. I'm going to talk about Destination Varsity, which is a project specifically on our campus. But first, a little background. If my mouse will work. No, it's not working. What's that doing? Thank you, Jifa, for reminding us. So I grew up in what I understood to be the Darling Downs as a white fella, which I now appreciate to be Burundung country. And more recently, I did secondary school on what we call in central Queensland, in country towns there, which is Durrumbul country. So that's a little bit from my background. And a little more background on this particular project, this Destination Varsity, and more specifically on how, let's say, the methodology that we use at architectural physics. It's based on my background bashing around in sheds with my dad when I was 16. That motorcycle on the screen there is a 1954 Triumph that was considered rubbish when I was a kid. So I picked up three trailer loads of stuff with my dad and restored it as my first motorcycle. Here in the shed more recently is my daughter and wife helping me with its second restoration, because I didn't do a very good job as a kid. But more, what was deeply embedded during that time was my understanding of what it takes to make a system work. Old English motorcycles are notoriously terrible when it comes to electrics. If any little thing isn't connected properly, nothing works. The lights don't work, the bulbs blow, and the policemen pull you over, especially if you're a young guy riding a funny looking motorbike. So with the tutelage of James Murray Parks, a physicist who has a special superpower that allows him to see algorithms in his mind and write them down on pad, he's taught us to think about our projects as an algorithm where everything is linked and connected properly, in a circuit, if you like. And I realize that is actually something that I've been doing all my life, but hadn't articulated it so clearly. So the project I'm going to talk about is a collaboration between the University of Newcastle, Technotia Laboratories, which is James Murray Park's research lab, and architectural physics. I'm essentially showing you what we have shown infrastructure, and the outline is the project ambitions, the broader context of the project, some ideas for this campus, and our design methodology. And then some initial moves, two small projects that we've started doing, and indeed the next steps, which I think we'll enjoy chatting about today. I'm going to watch the time here and finish in about 20 minutes, okay? So a key challenge for the campus is bums on seats, particularly now, particularly since most university campuses have lost a certain proportion of their students due to the limitations of overseas travel. University of Newcastle is less reliant on that, more something in the order of, I think, 18%, not the 20 or 25 or 30 of some campuses. But let's start with some local context about Newcastle. What kind of town is it? Well, it's a mining town, it's industrial. So it's understandable that probably around 80% of school leavers in Newcastle end up going to TAFE. I mean, you have a very good TAFE here. It's home to some of the most, this is what the TAFE say, home to some of the most advanced equipment in Australia. TAFE, New South Wales, Newcastle, is a beacon of opportunity for the people of the Hunter region, where they can come, learn, prosper, and create an exciting future for themselves and their local community. So that's what the campus is up against. And so what can we do to replace those lost overseas students? We think we can replace them with locals who would typically go to TAFE. And how many of those could we attract to protect the future of this university campus? So here are some ideas. And this particular idea has come from Sue Ann, that what if we aligned our academic offerings at the school to be more aligned with industry? What if it was what we taught was more of an applied approach? For example, in our school, what about construction architecture, or a degree that teaches us to design for modern methods of construction, i.e. how to design for manufacture and assembly? The MBAs, for example, the Masters of Business, could in fact be set the task of making existing infrastructure make more money. The key point could be that no degrees are offered on our campus unless the content works and it's actually valued by industry. What else have we observed about Newcastle? I'm new to it, so is James, the team here. Troy's on our team as well, but he's pretty new to Newcastle. James, my good friend, has a cup that, you know, a mug that he was given as a gift from a local that says there are five icons of Newcastle. And we don't really recognise any of them in particular. None of them are particularly special. There's a beach, a mining gantry, a headland. And the other one is Port Stephens, which actually takes you away from Newcastle. So our point here is Newcastle actually lacks icons, although my friend Dan Jager has taught me the connection between, of course, the icon of Silverchair and that funny looking tower that you guys have got. So what if we started by creating attractors on the campus, things that actually work, that possibly demonstrate technology from the varsity, from the university itself, and that they were somehow distributed around the campus in a way that were markers. Another thing we've observed the first time I came to meetings at the campus is parking is a massive challenge. On further investigation, it appears that something like, you have around 1,000, over 1,000 academics and 1,600 professional staff on campus, nudging 3,000 people who are using up the car parking. I can provide a source for that. I won't slow things down. But what if we found ways of employing new technology and incentives to facilitate staff organising themselves into carpooling or minibuses or electric bikes or something, shuttle services, that actually release some of that parking? So there's a couple of ideas there, but now I'd like to discuss our design methodology and how we approach this issue. Firstly, I suppose in physics there's always a point of induction, and in this case it's the Vice Chancellor who approached infrastructure and facility services who approached us to think about this issue. So that was the point about if we actually engage the individual departments or schools to create courses that are valued by industry, and that the MBAs are finding ways of employing the existing facilities to make them viable and more efficient, and working with Sue-Ann and others, that we actually create some kind of sanctuary for the wildlife and understand the balance of the ecology in our campus. There's remarkable opportunities there. And that these, some kind of markers that are technologically useful, maybe communication of some sort, probably paid for by industry or sponsored by industry. So the idea here is this is not to open this campus up, is not actually costing us money, but actually being neutral. If this work is done well and we make the edges of this campus more permeable, then we start to get tourists or visitors, icons to the campus. People who are visiting Newcastle would also be attracted to visiting the campus itself. This generates more and more traffic on site and starts to boost interest in engaging in courses and enrolling. We solve the parking, and the whole thing starts to work viably, and money goes back to Mr. Vice-Chancellor, and away we go again, generating more projects and more implementation of the campus. So the idea here is that the key objective is that we put Newcastle on the map and get the campus to be drawing from a wider net. And of course, as those students are trained and doing their good work, they go back, spread the word. And of course, in a post-COVID world or during even, through online means, we start to feed back a broader cycle of well-educated students spreading the word about our university and really getting that on the map. So that's kind of where we're at the moment. And the idea is that this project, this overall approach starts to be implemented. And our first little move was looking at the ATC building, and it's a project we call OWL, as in Owl Wing Laboratory. And it's a little room hanging off the end of this Advanced Technology Centre that we're looking at as a kind of interface, an educational knowledge sharing room. At the moment, it's a staff common room, and these are drawings by Jackson, Teese, Chesterman, Willis that we based our work on. and it's a little sloping building sitting on a sloping site. Our inspirations come from the context of the site, and in particular, the light and shade of the forest area that we find ourselves in, the shadows, the nature of the changing times of day and light, and the verticality of what is right outside this little funny shaped quadrant building. We're quite interested in how it hangs off the edge of a more significant building and how it interfaces with the reinstated artificial nature, let's call it, of the campus. This is a little view from it above with these trees that are kind of choked. It's kind of a sad little situation for those trees. And some unused space around the peripheral of it. Inside, it looks a little bit like this, just a low-key staff room. It is accessed via a ramp from which our ideas were formulated. And this is James talking about his vision for the project. We've called it OWL, as in Owl Wing Laboratory, not for any literal reason, but more about the actual nature of owl wings themselves and the feathers. It's actually all about the edge conditions, the physics of how those feathers interact with themselves and with the ambience around, as Ian calls it, the air. We're not treating just as air. The sound is not just sound. Just for those who are not familiar, an owl has the ability of silent flight. It allows it to approach its prey without being noticed. If you have other birds fly by you, you'll hear them coming. An owl, you won't. So it's the edges of the feathers, the edges of the wings we're interested in as a kind of analogy or metaphor for the edges of the campus, to how the campus interacts with the community beyond. And it is worth looking into how these remarkable creatures have evolved to fly silently. The inspiration here, this is James's hand, thinking about how we work around the existing trees and reach out into the landscape. We developed two options. One was Mr. Ortho, picking up on the on the 90 degree form of the Jackson Teats Pavilion. And then we also had another one. Is it gone? Mr. Edgy, there he is. And then the other one was called Mr. Edgy because it's a little more fragmented and makes some freer shaped rooms and a looser edge, if you like. It was Mr. Edgy that we settled on. There are a few issues, of course, to solve here that we're working on, such as infrastructure and how we deal around cascading decks and gathering spaces for people who are passing by, and how to maintain access to those service pits. And we're thinking in detail at the same time how we might make the screen walls or louver walls, how they deal with fire, sun, light, solar collection and the like. And some little discussions with Troy around the physics, if you like, and the different characteristics of roof cladding options that we're looking at, and how to deal with regular louvers and an irregular developed elevation due to the shape of this thing. Just sketches explaining our process. And the end result of, or the work in progress, let's call it, of this extension or this renovation of this little quadrant shaped thing. This is the status of it at the moment in 3D. And from the inside, it looks a little bit like that. And we start to see that idea of the shadows in the bush are well captured in the, let's call it, mottled light caused by louvers. So here's our Owl Wing Laboratory, that kind of idea of the campus interacting with the passers-by and the passers-by interacting with the facility, the building. The second project is and kind of entry pavilion. I don't know what that building's called, but it's, someone might put it in the chat. But we're trying to acknowledge a moment in time where people arrive at the campus. Now, this project is in response to a donation from Brookfield, from James Murray Park's head team. And it's reusing a project that was called Off the Grid Pavilion for the Off the Grid Festival in Melbourne in 2017, I think it was, It started with the idea, as I mentioned, of being an off-the-grid performance space. So it starts with solar panels, enough solar panels to drive a rock band performing an event. The team then needed to support those solar panels and anchor them down, because this is a lightweight temporary pavilion for just, I think, a 24-hour or a weekend period. So the framework was then held down with weights. And then we needed to support those solar panels with and accommodate the musicians. So this is the end result of it assembled. A temporary array of solar panels enough to drive some serious sound equipment. In action, 2017, yes, there it is. And I'd just like to acknowledge the work that produced this beautiful pavilion. And you can see there the donations were made by Brookfield Scientific Solutions Group and materials and design, as you can see. It was assembled in a day and a half. My mouse has stopped working. I've got a freeze. I beg your pardon. Okay, we're away now. So I think I've jumped around a little bit there, but we're out of time anyway. So thank you very much. And I think we're up for question and session now, Pia.
Yeah, I think what we might do because of time is move straight to Sue-Ann, so that then we can have a general conversation at the end, if that's okay.
Yeah.
Because I think we've only got 40 minutes left. But that was great. That was kind of moved us into the campus somewhat. And I think it also makes sense for Sue-Ann to follow on from that, because she's got a whole series of initiatives related to what you were talking about directly. So Sue-Ann, while Sue-Ann is sorting out her slides.
You're not, there it is. Jesus. You don't need to introduce me. It's okay, it's on the web and I'm not that important anyway. Given the lineup today, I'm going to try to go fast because I'm probably more interested in the Q&A and a discussion across the panel. But it was really interesting hearing some of the disconnects and connects across the three speakers before me. I'm going to start off with what I call regimes of care. And actually, I've appropriated that from, Leon von Schaich firstly, but then he's appropriated it from another discipline, which is generally in nursing. And it comes back to this idea of nurturing. And in my own practice, which is an activist practice, I often talk about regimes of care privilege, process over form. I'm not an architect, although I'm the head of an architecture and construction management school. I'm neither of those. I'm a landscape architect. And I know when people say, it's all about blurring boundaries, actually don't ever ask me to design a building. You'd be very sorry. And honestly, I rely quite heavily on the construction managers to understand how things are built and much more nuances around budget so that I can be tricky and do better work. Back to Living Labs. So this started as a series of conversations with colleagues from my own school in the Faculty of Engineering and Built Environment, from friends and colleagues in the Faculty of Science, from FEDUA, which is Education, Art and Humanities, and from Wolatuka, which is unique to the University of Newcastle, but also the Indigenous Strategy Leadership Group. And I wouldn't be worth my salt as a head of school if I didn't tell you that we do have the largest number of Indigenous students enrolled in our degrees across the university, at the University of Newcastle, in the entire country. And I know it's a little bit different in built environment, but we do have a significant student population. So Jeff, I'd love to talk to you about how many numbers we have, because it might challenge that notion of 70. Anyway, and then also, of course, IFS, who I think Ken alluded to, they're the people who get things built on campus. A lot of campuses talk about, and a lot of universities are interested in living laboratory, and I am very literal when I say living laboratory. This is about, we have a number of campuses, six within the Australia, in terms of campuses for the University of Newcastle. I'm going to focus today on Callaghan campus, which is where I am located. And what's important about Callaghan campus is that it's always being called a bush campus. And I guess you could say it is a bush campus of sorts, but if we're being honest, and I am nothing if not dreadfully honest about this, it's actually a place where ecological and human violence are constant, perpetuated, and ongoing. It used to be a BHP site. So what it looked like prior to being revegetated with only three species of trees and a very, what I'll say, Lamandra-dominated, incredibly unrich understory, to pretend that it's a bush campus, to even intimate that it's a bush campus, is somewhat funny. I think it's just because there's lots more trees here than perhaps in other places, because they've been destroyed, of course, for housing and other things. And I'll get into that in a second. So I'm nothing if I'm not political when I put out these provocations, and I'm perfectly happy to be taken down a few notches here. I've put the big red star on showing you where the architecture and built environment precinct is actually located. You'll notice we're close to a very big highway. I think you need to know that we've got 141 acres in this particular campus, 30 meter drop from say this end, which is the high end, down to this end, which is the front end on University Drive. It's not an ecologically diverse campus as much people would like to believe. And in fact, we have some major problems, and we're probably going to incur even more problems with climate change in the Anthropocene. So this call out with colleagues to have these regimes of care or these living laboratories is as much for the kind of enrichment of our current campus, but also recognizing that in the current state of the world, including COVID and post-COVID, where the investment of capital into sexy, groovy buildings is probably going to be delayed somewhat, hopefully from my perspective, and we might actually start investing back into our physical other environments and do it in a way which acknowledges what they can bring to bear, which is quite unique to say other campuses. So, and again, I'm very conscious of the word country here, and I don't misuse it in my title for this particular living laboratory, which underpins all the others. And all the researchers have said that, okay, if we don't get funding for anything else, we want funding for this one laboratory. And I use regimes of care for and with country. I'm very conscious of a number of researchers, including CSIRO and Indigenous rangers, who talk about caring for and with country very deeply. So, but what we are talking about quite literally is, well, what kind of learning environments and knowledge transfer where Indigenous regimes of care and with country are showcased, but are also experienced and felt in the study program. So it's not something that you look at in a book, it's something you experience spatially We do have some sites already on campus, but unfortunately they're limited and I would say corralled, and they're sort of captured in a pseudo bush or a pseudo suburban bush. And I guess while they're an initial attempt, they're simply not good enough. And I suppose in working quite closely with our Indigenous colleagues, this kind of respect for knowledge and deep collaboration pervades. And this laboratory, like I said, which underpins, really looks at, so what are Indigenous land management practices that are appropriate for campus, but also appropriate in the Anthropocene when we know we're gonna have less water and more heat? What are the ecological knowledges? How do we make sure that Indigenous IP is respected and that we don't just appropriate it or butcher it as we've done so many other things? And of course, on our campus, we have another opportunity in terms of bush tucker, which we kind of realize, but there's some definite, I'll say, challenges with the soil, as in we are a contaminated site, as is much of Newcastle. So the way we grow anything you eat or even touch, you have to be really careful about. And these are just some examples of sort of what's currently here. And again, we're talking about going across the entire campus now and stop coloring within the lines, with, you know, and not just having these, how can it sit in a more suburban environment out the front of buildings and things like that. So in a way, and very respectfully thinking about how does it happen in a not so bush, how can you have a cultivated sense of Indigenous environments and regimes of care? We have an incredible opportunity, and it's shrinking every day, where we can increase the biodiversity corridor. And I mean, this map is actually quite old, it's 2014, so it's probably incredibly out of date, but you can see all along the east and west and pretty much the edges where Australians tend to live, urban Australians and probably more European-wide Australians live, you can see what's happening to biodiversity. So what can we do in a campus where we're on the edge of a giant wetlands? How can we extend our biodiversity into campus and create another kind of wildlife corridor? It's never going to go back to what it was. It's never going to be pristine, but these kind of constructed ecologies and these constructed places that might allow for a new ecology to develop. That is, it's also a system between humans and non-humans. And the hope here, and I'm showing you all the universities that are doing research on various endangered ecologies and biodiversity, and you'll notice my particular university or the university we happen to be sitting in and speaking about today isn't on there. That's changed recently. But we have a desperate need to collect native seeds and provide stock for other revegetation projects, particularly in our region. So we could become a native plant seed nursery as well. This is something Ken alluded to, and it's actually something that the Vice Chancellor is very keen on. Those of you who don't know, it was quite entertaining this morning when we found out that our government in our state might change in New South Wales over koala habitat, because of course they're wanting to legislate, the current government, which is the Liberals, are wanting to legislate, let's keep koala habitat, let's enhance it, let's make sure these symbols of iconic Australian, I guess, beasties are not destroyed. And Ken himself is doing a really great project with our students and also with the Department of Forestry in this area. But, you know, the reason the government split is that the national parties, which tend to be the more regional and I'll say agriculturally held seats, don't want to be told what to do on their land in terms of koalas. And there's a whole range of reasons why it's a political thing. With us and a vice chancellor who wants to somehow activate our campus beyond students and staff and invite the community in, he sees it as a way again to help use the campus, leverage the campus to get others onto it. Beyond the selfies and the kind of minor things that you see at zoos and some other places that are really hideous to go to. It is kind of with 141 acres, which isn't densely populated by any means, there could be opportunities to partners with, in particular, those that are trying to rehab a lot of the
native animals that have been made homeless through the extensive fires we had last summer. This is probably a more, I'll say, normative aspect. However, I think we could do it in a Newcastle way. And we're now starting deep conversations with the National Herbarium. And we used to have, up until last year, a really interesting masters of natural history illustration. So we have a really interesting relationship between art, gardens, and botanica on our campus. And I guess those of you who are Victorians, you may recall Edna Walling and this whole idea that you can use native plants and in garden settings, and why not? So we have a lovely sandstone clad sign out the front of our terrific organization. And this is me sort of saying, well, what would happen if the campus had some aspects of botanica, some aspects of these kind of, you know, kind of inspired from the Cranbourne Botanical Gardens down in Melbs. But what would happen if we became a showcase for certain types of more formalistic plantings? And these, of course, would be in the appropriate settings. They wouldn't be everywhere where we have more opportunities to create biodiversity. We might do something different. Look, this is me taking the piss out of a recently put on hold building called the STEM building. And instead of having, you know, the usual lawn and crap up the front, and I'm sure that my mates who designed it at Aspect will probably beat me up about this, but really, why can't we have something where native plants are trialed rather than grass? I'm a bit over grass, guys. We've got plenty of grass on campus. And how might this, which is the exact site where Ken and Ignosia and Architectural Physics are talking about donating this pavilion because this building's gone on hold. But why wouldn't we want this, which is going to be at the entrance to our campus, to look like this rather than grass? And I'm constantly having some very entertaining conversations with those who may not like it. And you can see, this is for those of you who've never been on Callaghan campus, I'm probably speaking more to my fellow presenters, but this is actually how you access the campus. So why wouldn't we want it to be bright and bold and think about species with which bloom and are appropriate with water and sun cycles here? And as you can see, I'm just taking over the great lawn, which we have lots of great lawns, so why not? And me and my friends in science have all sorts of great time postulating how we can kind of corrupt our campuses. And of course, if you're gonna have water features, you know, you put them in the more suburban aspects and you use it to treat water and clean it. We don't recycle water well on our campus currently. A bit extensive. I'm gonna talk about three projects really quickly that are actually happening. So living laboratories are now propositions and they're with various committees that all universities have. They have a bit of, momentum behind them because we're not investing in buildings right now. Some universities still have that capital, but we certainly don't. They probably have more of a chance to get up now than ever. And because they have, as they've gained momentum, they keep gaining people, researchers, staff, and students. I suspect that at least the Indigenous one, regimes of country and care, working with local rangers, we'll get up by next year. So that's a good news story. This is a project which is actually being funded by the state government. And we started off in Sydney and it's really looking at how you can use plants to clean toxic soil. For those of you who don't live in places like Newcastle, I'd still urge you to get your soil tested before you plant anything. As you can see from this lovely map, we've got 1,000 sites of toxic and degraded soil in and around New South Wales, and 400 of them, so 40%, are in the city of Newcastle. We did a project earlier where we were at White Pay Power Station in Sydney. We had a bit of money left over. These are some of the plants we tested on site just to see what they could take out. And for those of you who don't know a lot about phytoremediation, I could give a whole lecture about that. But essentially, some plants metabolize toxins out of soil and they actually sweat them out and they destabilize the chemical compounds. Other plants absorb them into their bodies and hold them into the roots or into their systems. But they actually can deal with highly degraded soils. And that's what's really important here. So the site that we're working on that we've just got and we'll probably be planting, hopefully, knock on wood, in October is here. This is BHP prior to its closing down in its full glory. And much of Newcastle still reflects this kind of industrial, post-industrial heritage. More closely, so you can see here, this is the Hunter River. This is where the coal berths still are. So we're still alive and well, coal working town. And these are the old sheds that you saw in the foreground. Our site is just right here. And the university now owns this site. It's called the Del Pratt Cottage. Del Pratt was the, he was like the CEO of BHP in Newcastle. And he wanted a house on site so he could watch his workers. It's a funny little site, Federation architecture, right off Industrial Drive, which is a 80 kilometer per hour heavy duty road. Still got lots of really cool remnant buildings, entirely sanctioned up, has lots of fencing, but we've taken it over and the aim of the university is to open it up. But we're also working with the Newcastle Industrial Heritage Association on this project. Prior to becoming BHP, and I would venture to say, having conversations with some friends and I'll say Indigenous friends and people who work through Wallachuca, a couple of Awabakal land council holders have talked to us about this part of the river and its importance in terms of fishing and its importance in terms of, it was a boggy site and it was a really interesting site. That's obviously now all been changed. For BHP, but at one point, in some point of our settlement, it was meant to be a botanic gardens, which is even interestinger. So you can see what this house kind of looked like during the heyday and what it kind of, well, the bottom view is what it currently looks like, the requisite fig tree. It's actually a heavily vegetated site and it's got some camphor laurels and some fantastic figs. And what we're actually proposing to do is use a series of garden typologies, because we're also mindful that we are in the middle of what I would call suburbia in Mayfield, on the edge of it in this place. And so why wouldn't we plant both native and exotic species and test exactly how much toxins and what kinds of toxins they can take out? So as a demonstration project for the rest of Newcastle and others to see. And this is very much what we did. We did cropping projects in Sydney, but here we're doing it very much as a garden-esque kind of, I would say, exercise. Next to the building, the requisite cottage garden, Edna Walling style, mixing natives and exotics. Just here, you'll see a vegetable garden and a fruiting garden and I'll caution you now, if you live in Newcastle, again, get your soil tested, but root vegetables in particular and pumpkins are amazing at taking toxins out, which means if you eat them, you might be eating some interesting stuff. We're looking at various indigenous and native species in our orchards and then some meadows and more broadacre treatments down the bottom, just so we don't disturb the roots of these very large fig trees. So these are some incredible sort of, again, you'll notice the aesthetics a bit more wild and woolly than I suspect a cottage garden might have been at the time. Obviously, we've got to be really careful about the signage. This place isn't open to the public. It's highly controlled in terms of its entry, but we don't want anyone eating anything. it's not a good thing. We've also got agreement from the Industrial Heritage Society to hold concerts and to test some of the hypotheses that we've been reading about do plants actually grow better if you've got people talking to them and singing to them. So there's some other things planned as another way of activating this kind of interesting site. And that's the interesting view you get still if you go there today. This is a very, very short project that we did last year as part of the Vice Chancellor's challenge, Grand Challenge, which is on again. All universities, I think, have these grand challenges. Ours is always around campus environments, or for the last 2 years. And it was really about, we have a problem here with an overpopulation of mosquitoes, partially because of our relationship to wetlands, partially because we've destroyed our, I'll say, systems or ecological systems so badly that all the drainage lines don't have enough diversity. And so all the things that would normally eat mosquitoes don't. So therefore humans become the best fodder ever. With those things out of balance, you have to then think about, well, how can you recalibrate these things? But being respectful that we don't want to kill all the mozzies, which is currently a lot of spraying goes along, a lot of DEET, people pretty much wear it as your perfume. It is called the Novocastrian perfume at the moment, DEET or Aragard, what's your flavor? And I guess we wanted to figure out a way to cohabitate. And this was done in collaboration with the people you see there. And it was a kind of a fun project to do inside of the school. So basically mosquitoes are attracted to your smell and to carbon dioxide. And they come and they're in our case, they're in search of food because there's not a lot of livestock around. So all we wanted to do was confuse them a bit. And one of the ways of confusing mosquitoes, and this is why citronella and other scents work, is that basically they can't smell your BO or your blood or your CO2 if they're smelling citronella or lavender or other heavily scented plants. But we didn't want to just plant gardens. We wanted to, you know, sort of borrow from some of the guerrilla gardening things we've seen around. And we thought, all right, and we also want to have other people participate. We just don't want it to be us. And so came up with this idea of seed bombs and gumball machines. So we installed our prototype pre-COVID with all sorts of hope. and we did a lot of really interesting, I'll say, educational events with local school groups where we had them make seed balls and taught them about various ecologies. We were also concerned because they do kind of look like protein balls to make sure that people didn't eat them. This is just outside of the architecture building, the design studio, and basically all the funding we got from students and others buying seed bombs, we've donated back to koala reserves. There is a koala theme. On the launch, there's a few people in the audience and some are growing, but most have died because they sprayed. Last one, sorry. This one we just recently installed. It's important to note that when you come off the train, if you ride the train, often you come up this space into the Richardson Wing, which is the nursing and midwifery precinct. It's also the first time you set foot on Awabakal land if you arrive by train. So we had this brief, we showed a couple of options. This is the one that the Indigenous and non-Indigenous selected, and it's Hardenbergia, which has some really interesting Indigenous bush tucker and bush medicine properties, as well as it's an indicator species for when certain fish are in water courses, so you go and fish. It's also used for fishing nets and other things within local Indigenous practices. This is us installing it. And the idea was, hey, welcome to the nursing precinct, welcome to the University of Newcastle. And rather than signs and wayfinding, how about we plant a giant purple vine that kind of threads you through? And at the moment, why did we do this pop-up project? We obviously put out tables and chairs and we tried to enhance their bush garden, their bush medicine garden, which has sort of died off in a few recent years. The pop-up project was really to test what would happen and if people would activate these spaces before the university spends more money on this space, before it gets, so we're currently collecting data on who's using it. Are they liking it? And I've forgotten to say that purple is the signature color of nursing and midwifery. So purple was also important. I think that's that. Sorry about that.
Thank you, Suanne. So now I'm really keen to open up to discussion and questions in the little bit of time we've got left. And so I'm going to ask people if they want to, if they have questions, to say so in the chat so I can find you and we can move to you, you can speak them or say them. But before we do that, I just want to make one point, and that is that, you know, and what we've seen is a whole lot of notions of opening up the University of Newcastle campus and a series of initiatives that will be part of that. But to move back to what Jifa and Ian were saying, and Ian sort of drawing an attention to the importance of practices and specifically practices of relationality, which raise questions about how we move to doing any of those things, which I think then with Jifa talking about, and this is a really striking one that I'm going to stay with, slowing down to speed up, to in order to listen, in order to reveal, and truth-telling and transformation, I think is really critical as part of those practices. And given that the school is also really interested in creative practice research, the idea of practice and practices is something that we want to interrogate. So the thing of how we move ahead, or how we even move, I mean, what do we stop doing as well and start doing more of as these projects start to unfold? I think that's an important question for the students to, as they start to think about many of the projects that they're doing that are related to the campus. So Ian's saying slow is always the new fast. But I think it is important. I think that is a really important notion. So I want to throw it open from there. So Ian, you're disappearing.
Sorry. Or in the desk.
Does anybody want to ask any questions? I can keep going. But I don't really want to. I want to give the opportunity to others. I can't. Troy, I know you had one.
It's in the chat.
Yeah, I just popped in the chat. It's directed kind of, I guess, to Jifa, but also to all the speakers, because you're all in positions of leadership, I guess you could say. And there is a big, I feel, sincere approach that all of the students like taking. And a lot of us are here at this university because of the involvement with Walatuka. And how do we make sure that we're sincere in our approach and not so tokenistic, as a lot of people, I guess, get misrepresented at being, is the question. Yeah.
I mean, I think I'll be the most outspoken about this. And if you look at some of our even newest buildings, where there's an application of indigeneity rather than investing in Indigenous people as a part of the project in the very beginning, and not like they're co-designers, they're co-creators, and trying to do that with some of the new things we're doing on campus. But to be honest, it's a learning process, and as we all get more understanding of Indigenous culture and IP, IP issues in particular, but Indigenous knowledges, and that's both, you know, kind of things that you can record and intangible things. I think it's about inclusion. And again, I think we're terrible at it in the built environment. It just is something that building schedules and procurement schedules and all this stuff that to ignore, and even consultation, it's not the same as co-design. So we're trying to flip that on its head in a time where capital and other things are less available, so that when we do have money, or if we do make some sort of investment, we do it well or better than we have.
Yeah.
And further to that, I think a lot of it comes back to intellectual laziness of not actually investing in the necessary research, time, conversations to really, you know, seek the requisite permissions and cultural authority to proceed with particular stories or references or imagery. And ultimately, it's about focusing principally on representation rather than delving deep and thinking about how do you infuse it within the design thinking as opposed to the aesthetics, and ultimately too, it's about understanding the multiple sophistication and complexity and diversity that exists, and you know, challenging some of those standard tropes means you move beyond the kitsch, the cliche, the stereotypical, and ultimately, I think it's about processes of adaptation and transformation, and you know, for me, that's where it becomes quite compelling. Is how do you take the seed of an idea or a concept and then translate that, but also drawing upon one's own personal connection and how it resonates with you. So the moment you start to personalize it and understand your own ethical and philosophical position and responsibility, it presupposes that you're not going to have necessarily a standard approach. You actually start to engage in a much more nuanced way.
Yep.
And you know, I think we've kind of got to a level of cultural maturity now where, you know, even traditional owners are going, well, you know, gone are the days of hanging a boomerang on the wall or a dot painting. That just ain't going to cut it anymore. They're actually seeking much more engagement. They actually want the sophistication to be writ large into propositions, and you know, there is a lot of knowledge that comes through in yep. that.
Thank you.
Shelley's also added a nice point that it's also about building trust through long-term relationships rather than constant consultation. It's possible.
That's right.
I would add, I love this word laziness, but I really think that it's not about building buildings, it's about building futures, you know, and that other worlds are possible. And we have to think about, you know, capital. We have to think about, you know, climate change. We have to think about modes of being alive and ontologies, and that other worlds are possible. And we have to bring all of that to bear on the question. And it's like, I would just challenge people as designers, like, what's the cosmology of a flat floor? What's the cosmology of a door? Like, why are we, you know, I think taking Jeffy's idea of laziness, why do we assume these are like the givens of a building? And why are these the givens of our future world? You know, can we think beyond native and invasive? Can we imagine new ecologies? Can we imagine new practices? Can we imagine emergent cosmologies? And if we're not willing to do that, and then we're just going back to just stamping shit on shit.
Yeah, thank you, Ian.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm sorry, I'm going to speak up. I'm not a native plant defender by any means. And in fact, I often liken what Australia does with natives and non-natives to the same thing around what we do with refugees. But yeah. I think that climate change and what's really happening in the world is kind of testing us around what ecologies are in the first place, as well as what human versus native and all that binary separation, which doesn't really exist. There have been people looking at this for 300 years. Why haven't we cracked it? Because again, in my education, which is thousands of years ago now, we were talking about this silly divide between nature and culture. And for me, it's like, so why haven't we cracked it? What is it because of latent forms of capitalism? Is it, you know, why, or indigenous, non-indigenous, you know, humans versus plants? Why? I mean, you talked a lot about California, which is where I'm from. All the grasses got wiped out when the conquistadores brought the sheep in. There are no native grasses left in any part of California. So for me, it's like, we've known this, we've been fighting it, we know about climate change, we've been fighting it, but why haven't we cracked it?
Are you suggesting that we never will?
I think it's a fundamental
question. Very depressing outcome.
Totally on board, Suzanne.
Yeah. Amber, also, does anyone want to address that before Amber's question? Okay, let's go to Amber.
Hi.
And then I have to, yeah.
I guess it's not so much a question, but more just like your thoughts on, and I'm interested in this space between, it might come across clunky how I'm articulating this, but like Indigenous and non-Indigenous, and that gap of sharing storytelling and information, basically Indigenous knowledge in a way that the non-Indigenous people might want to learn. And this idea of collection, storytelling, commodifying and curating. And I guess I read an article by an Indigenous man, I've forgotten where he's from, sorry, but Nathan, and he was talking about memory institutions, so galleries and things like that, and saying that their stories are there in those places, but their voices are missing. And that idea of non-Indigenous people commodifying Indigenous stories and artifacts and things and taking them out of context because they are appealing visually to us or whatever. So I guess just this idea of how do you join these two worlds, I guess, without commodifying. And I was talking to Shelley about this, and taking advantage of someone's trauma. Sorry, it's a bit of a doozy of a question.
Yeah, I guess my reflections on that question is we have to tap into our shared humanity. And I often say, in many respects, if we delve deep enough, everyone's Indigenous from somewhere. So how do we actually bring forward our own stories and engage with it? And ultimately, you know, I think that culture is what makes us human in many respects. And, you know, we've all had the ability to actually engage in that holistic way where we understood everything is interconnected. And the moment you sort of change it, you disrupt the natural flows. And, I remember, going on the Glenn Merck International Masterclass and Uncle Max Dullamunaman Harrison, which many of you may well have come across, sort of revealed quite clearly the fact that we have the ability to read the landscape and to understand how things work, but we've kind of lost it. But it's sort of making the invisible visible is in essence what we're needing to do. And, you know, the moment you start to become in tune with the natural flows of the way things work, you can start to then engage with those stories in meaningful ways. And that way you're actually engaging where you shift from the sort of the subtlety of appropriate versus appropriate. You know, spelled exactly the same, but the nuance of language really sort of reinforces that the fineness of how we start to engage in those sort of ways. You know, it's not really about separating Indigenous from non-Indigenous. It's really about, you know, facilitating knowledge exchange and understanding that we're all on a learning journey, you know, in the same sense that, you know, my mob is Wawong Kamilaroi country in northwest New South Wales. When I go and do some work in the Pilbara or, you know, on the Great Australian Bight as I've been doing recently, equally, I have to find a way in. I have to find a connection and build on those relationships and build trust and find a way in. And that starts with respect and goodwill and an open dialogue rather than a sort of a pre-supposed solution and sort of or imposed solution before you've actually even arrived. And so often it really requires us to speak less and listen more.
Mm. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Jupiter. That also kind of answers to a question that came to me privately from someone about being an international student and being sensitive about Indigenous designs. And I think the idea that you raise about tapping into our shared humanity is a really important one in relation to the commons as well. Like that's kind of like that we're all Indigenous from somewhere. It's something to remember, but that somewhere is where we're coming from. Which is not somewhere else.
I think it's like a mistake to think that humans are separate from environments. You know, like the term Indigenous is in a way a weird Western concept, you know, which is to say that some people are of a place and some people aren't, but that there's no way to be a human without being of a place, being entangled with an environment. And it's really a question of modality, like what type of care for place are you interested in? What care for place are you developing? And a lot of our modalities are not really concerned with other species and other environments and histories and trajectories and what have you. And so, I mean, I wish there was a better word than Indigenous, you know, which is to say like which is binary. There's some people who are not of a place and there's some people who are of a place. And we really think of what type of placemaking do we want to entangle with? And I think that's a fundamental question as like architects or placemakers, and that it has to go beyond the human. I think it's really important that we're considering not just species, but what we would call, I guess, you know, in English, like features of a landscape, like a river as a being, a mountain as a being, a cloud. Like, are there other modalities of engagement that would lead to a different form of indigeneity?
Look, I'm really aware that we've gathered here today a bunch of very busy people, and that we've just gone over time. There is, I think, one more question. Is everyone happy for us to do that? Or do people need to run away? It's okay. Okay, so William, you've got your hand up. Did you want to ask a question?
Yeah, thanks, Bea. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Can you? Yep. Just a couple of things. Just going back to what Sue Ann was talking about why we've been talking about some of these issues for 20 or 30 years and haven't seemed to have made much ground on them. I, one thing about that is I think our value system, like we value, like we look at people with money and they've got a certain value. So I think our value system needs to shift. I think that would be an interesting way to, you know, to move away from capitalism and consumerism. And then the other thing is, as a principal, or as I spoke to Emma about this, as a principal or an approach to design, reverence would be a nice place to start, as in like a deep respect for everything, Indigenous people, environment, community, so things like that. And just one, I'd just like to thank everyone for talking today, but just Jeffa, just wanted to know, have you read Dark Emu, and what do you think as a way of white people with a start to understand Indigenous people?
Yeah, well, I think the beauty of Dark Emu and Bruce Pascoe's contribution is he's essentially just going back to the raw data and information that's out there and just revealing it. It's holding a mirror back up to society to say, well, this information was known. And he's essentially aggregated it to tell the story and to challenge a sense that Indigenous culture lacks sophistication, had no contribution or desire to engage in any form of agriculture, didn't, you know, groom the landscape to suit human occupation. It just challenges and throws out the window all these tropes which are proven beyond a doubt to be false. And so what that enables is, I think, it provides a cultural bridge to connect to our deeper history of which we all share. So if we work, live, or engage in this country, we share this history as well. So we're not losing 240 years of history, we're gaining 67,000 years of history.
I've heard reconciliation framed like that lately, and it's a really nice way to look at it, I think. It's very inclusive, it's fantastic.
I would just say, Dark Emu and what you're saying, Jeff, has had a huge impact, in North America. And it's a huge awakening and pivot point.
Yeah, it is a really important book. I just want to say Shelley's also chimed in on the chat to make a nice comment about, she says, I guess it depends if you see yourself of a place or on a place, which goes back to what Ian was talking about, and also Jeeva. It's sort of like, it is a significant difference, and how we can be of places in different ways too, I think. Yeah. So I think we might have to draw this to a close. I think that this has probably been a really important session for many students. There are a whole lot of students in fourth year in particular who are working on the campus as their site this semester. So from moving from sort of very big picture, sort of ontological viewpoints from Ian and the very specific, through to the very specific projects being worked on by Ken and also by Sue Ann in those campuses, I think that it today sort of offered. And obviously the interest in ways of looking at indigenising the campus is really very strong. And I think, Jeffrey, your contribution has very evidently been incredibly important today. That's why I've been wanting to get you to talk here for ages. So I thank you all really very much. And thank you to everybody who came. I hope that the conversation continues in various forms and in various places. We were going to also ask or call for students to do pop-ups in the campus, in whatever that means, as acts of seeing the campus as radical commons. So if any students have any ideas that they want, where they want to organize events or have any kind of gesture or whatever in the campus as part of their projects or outside of them, just contact us and see if we can support that in some way. So I guess we end it here. It's very weird doing this on Zoom, I have to say. I wish we could go and have lunch and chat outside somewhere, but anyway, that's the way it is. So thank you everyone again, and look forward to future conversations.
Thank you, Pia, and everyone. Yes. Really wonderful.